Apple has finally decided that it's a product company. What they mean by that is that Apple, one of the companies that Apple sees itself as being like is Sony. Sony is a company that creates many of the markets it sells in. I think Apple came to that realization not so much from the Apple II, because the Apple II happened in a way where it was hard for them to even see that they had created, in some sense, a business for IBM to move into. But I think that the success of desktop publishing caught their attention, where they realized that, oh yes, IBM is just setting up a 2,000-person group in Colorado to do desktop publishing. That's about a third of the employees Apple has. I think now we realize, oh yeah, now what we are is a product company. We're going to listen to customers, but we also are going to try and come up with new ideas, creating new markets, and see if the customers will go along with us. I like that very much, of course, because the big problem in all marketing theories where you go out and ask the customers what they want is that customers almost always say, well, I want something just like what I have right now, except with these little things fixed. We have to listen to that, but you don't get new products from that. A couple of months ago, I was reading Toynbee, and the discussion was, how do you judge the worth of a civilization? Is it by the quality of their art, the size of their buildings, the social systems that they have? And I think 100 years from now, we will be judged, yay, by the complexity of the audiovisual equipment we need to put on a presentation. There we go. That's not much of a picture, is it? Now, what I'm going to try and do is, instead of talking about future trends, because I don't even believe in the word trends, and instead of just telling you what I think the future is going to be, I'd like to do is to just tell you the way I predict the future when people ask me what's going to happen, so that you'll be able to do it, and then I won't have to give these talks anymore. So, four ways to predict the future. Well, the first way came about in the early days of Xerox PARC, when we had Xerox executives buzzing around like bees after honey, saying, what's the future going to be like? What's going to happen to us? What's going to shape us and all these things? And I finally got angry at them. I said, look, the best way to predict the future is to invent it. If you want a future, come up with a vision and then build it, and you've successfully produced the future because you've simply made the future come out the way you want it. That's what research people are for, is to invent the future. Another one, a very sobering thing, is it takes at least 10 years to go from a working good idea in a laboratory to get it out in the outside world. And this is something I didn't believe in for many years when I was younger, because it was so depressing, an idea. But in fact, there are many instances of the 10-year story. And if it's a really basic technology like transistors, it may take 20 years. Because a basic technology has to displace the existing basic technology in order to take hold. I'm going to come back to that, because one of the implications of the 10-year idea is that it means that most things that are going to happen to you in the next 5 to 8 years are in somebody's research lab right now. So if you want to know what's going to happen, all you have to do is go around the country and visit people in their research labs and see what they're doing, and then you'll know the answer. Right? Brought a satchel full of tapes of various things from people's research labs that I'm going to show you at the end of the talk. A lot of these tapes are older than 10 years old. And the reason for that, I'll explain in the last part of the talk. Another way of predicting the future is to realize that what we're about here is the invention of new kinds of information media. And there have already been bunches of information media invented over the last several thousands of years. So if you take printing as an example, there are four phases to how you make money, and how you make money pushes these media through their four phases. The first one is hardware intensive. When the new hardware is invented, you get high margins on the hardware. The problem is that's the most transitory phase, because hardware is the easiest thing for people to learn how to build. And once you've learned how to build it, you are making it much more of a commodity item. The margins go down, you have competition, and so forth. And that's really what happened to printing. In the early days of printing, they made most of their money actually on paper, the margins on paper. And it wasn't until the Industrial Revolution that made paper inexpensive that you started seeing throwaway media like the novel. Now, the novel had been around for several hundred years as an isolated art form, but it didn't take hold until paper became cheap, and we had to go into the second phase, which is the software phase. We all know that software is a lousy business to be in, right? Because it's inherently a cottage industry. No publishing house has ever been able to sustain itself on having a captive stable of authors. They've always had to go out. And most people in publishing who have been smart go into distribution. Because distribution is the first aspect of the third phase, which I call service. By service, I don't mean fixing things so much, but of going from these things, which are basically selling items, to selling service, you address much more closely this quaint idea that there's actually a human being at the other end of the transaction. And the business that we're in is inescapably a service business, even though most companies that are selling computer products right now would think of themselves as either hardware manufacturers or software designers. But the urge, sort of the medium, the forcing function of networking especially, forces us to become a service business. And then the one where you really make the money, so if you can hang in there, is the fourth phase, which is way of life. The way of life I define as anything that is only noticeable when it's not there. So for instance, if you walk into, 10 years ago, if you walked into somebody's office and you didn't see a telephone, you would be really surprised. Nowadays, if you walk into a person's office and you don't see a telephone, you would say, oh, are you wearing yours now? Is your phone wired into your t-shirt? We're big on t-shirts down here. Now, so let's test this out here. I'd like everybody in the room to hold up their personal computer. Where is it? Okay, some watches, little calculator. Okay, so I rest my case. I doubt if there's an Apple computer or anybody else's computer in this room. And that means that, oh, there's one over there. Well, ignore that one. It's what physicists call experimental error. But I think the point is well made that there's something about the computer right now that makes it not, it's basically not important enough for you to have one with you right now. Something about it that causes you to leave it behind. One of the things about it is it's too big. Another thing about it is that it doesn't do enough when you make it small. So the real personal computer, at least when I envisioned the phrase personal computer many years ago, I thought of something that you would never leave behind. One of the tests at Xerox PARC we came up with for is it a personal computer was, would you be willing to do anything so mundane with your personal computer as to put your grocery list on it, be willing to carry it into the supermarket, and then out again with two bags of groceries? In other words, a personal computer is something, first, that is so portable you can carry something else too, because it's not the only thing you're going to carry. And secondly, 0.5 herniations per block is not portability. So this way of life phase is very important. It's the one that I have been interested in for 20 years, is what do you have to do to the damn thing to get it to be a way of life for people? And finally, human trait amplification. This is sort of how you predict the big winners. This is something I first pointed out to Xerox many years ago. They used to like to try and do market surveys on things. And I have to tell you a Xerox story, that Xerox, in the 50s, was a very small company in Rochester. And they had developed this obscure technology invented by Chester Carlson into a machine called the 914. And they didn't have enough money to build factories for it, so they took it to IBM. I think it was in 1956. This is all described, by the way, for people who are interested in this kind of lore, in John Dessauer's book, which is called My Years with Xerox, The Billions Nobody Wanted. And this is sort of a perfect parable of life in the 20th century. So Dessauer's story goes on to say that Xerox took this to IBM, and they said, here, take this, build factories, build it, and sell it. All we want is a small royalty. And IBM scratched its collective head and said, well, we don't know about that. So they went out and hired a consulting firm, Arthur D. Little. Mike Hammer's definition of a consultant is a person who knows 100 ways to make love but doesn't have a girlfriend. My definition is it's a person who steals from the smart and sells to the stupid. sort of an inverse Robin Hood. But anyway, after 18 months of carefully doing market surveys and other things consulting firms do, Arthur D. Little came back to IBM and said, nope, it'll never sell. There's too great a disparity between it and the A.B. Dick mimeograph machine, and nobody wants plain paper copying, and there isn't enough copy volume to sustain copying and all that stuff. And so IBM turned it down. And that really pissed Joe Wilson off, who was the head of Haloid Corporation in those days. And a bunch of the executives got together, and they used their life insurance as security. This is the same way Control Data got started, by the way, out of Remington Rand. Raised the money for their first factories. And that was about $120 billion ago. It's a perfect example of when the technology is actually new, it's almost impossible to go out and do a market survey and find that there is a need for it. Because as we'll see in a minute, really great stuff creates a need. That's what all of the want. So I pointed out to Xerox that another way of predicting these things was simply to look at traits that human beings have, that if the trait was taken away, we would call a person no longer human, like communication. Humans are not natural hermits. We have to communicate. And we don't do it just because it's useful, we do it because we need to. So whenever you make a communication amplifier, and no matter sort of Kay's law back then was, even if it costs 10 times as much as the technology is trying to displace, if it's really a better amplifier for communication, it's going to drive it out. Perfect example is the railroads in the early 1900s thought they were improving their business by making better track and faster locomotives. They were looking out like this along the tracks, and what they didn't see was their competition starting to buzz overhead, because they conclusively proved that there was no way that aircraft transportation could be as cheap as trains. And they were absolutely right and totally irrelevant, because people were quite happy to pay 5, 6, 7, 10 times as much for being able to get there much faster, and even getting their freight there much faster. So here's another one that I pointed out to Warner's and Atari, that fantasy amplifiers are big also. And the reason for that is that even when we think we're in reality, we're dwelling in a fantasy or in a hallucination that is partly a product of our culture and our upbringing, as well as what our senses bring to us. And a third one is control. It's one of the biggest traumatic shocks we have as a child growing up is when we start dimly sensing that the universe isn't in our control. I remember that, I think I first realized that when I was about 3 years old, and I've never gotten over it since. But in fact, this idea of trying to be able to control things, that amplifiers that allow us to control various things and so forth, are very important also. And simply, you can tell very often whether a new product is going to make it if it really does amplify one of these or other human traits. You don't have to go out and ask people. They can't tell you that. Just as Sony did not market test, when they went out and tried to do the Walkman, nobody wanted the Walkman until Sony built 5,000 of them and gave them to people. If you can give something to people and they can hold it in their hand, then they know whether they like it or not. And that's one of the reasons the Japanese have been so successful, is that they know the way to do market analysis is not to go out and ask the questions before you do the product. What you do is you do the product and then see what people think about it, because then they actually have an aid to their imagination. Let me just follow up on three ways to invent something. This is the most popular way. Take whatever's around, shove it together, and ask what you've got. That's called brainstorming. Something these productivity books think is important, but in fact, it's the worst way to do anything, because people are usually lousy at thinking on their feet, and they're terrible at thinking inside of a room. People need sand under their feet to do good thoughts, or maybe a shower or something. Better way is the problem-solving method, find a need and fill it. But the one that really wins is to make something that creates a problem only it can solve. That's exactly what the Xerox machine was. Nobody had a copying problem until the Xerox 914 came along. Nobody had a calculation problem until the HP 35 came along. The HP 35 and calculators were predicted against for the simple reason that nobody did calculations up till then. There were desk calculators around, and people didn't realize that the simple access to calculation gratuitously was an important part of it. And of course, the personal computer itself is an example of that. Nobody had a personal computing problem until PCs came along, and now we all do. Possibly. Very possibly. Okay, I'll just give you a few more slogans and homilies here. Another one is about literacy. My definition of literacy is that literacy is fluency, not familiarity. I usually show the slides to educators, because educators think if they make a child familiar with a computer, then the child is computer literate. But in fact, it's not true. I believe literacy has three parts. There's an access part. That means somebody else makes up the material, and you have the skills to get to whatever that material is. We call that reading in the print medium. And the Macintosh is a good example of how to solve the access problem to operating systems and applications. Second area we don't do so well at, which is called creation fluency. In the print medium, that's writing. And writing is an example of something where we expect somebody who's literate to be able to write a two pages of something, advancing a point of view and substantiating it in order to convince somebody. And this two-page thing is very important, because most people have a very difficult time dealing in large number of pages of anything, even for people who can write. So it's very important for English, through the use of metaphor, to be able to express fairly complex ideas in a couple of pages. Programming languages are terrible for that. Almost all programming languages to do anything interesting in takes you far beyond several pages. And one of the things we found out at Xerox PARC years ago is that if it's a trade-off between an easy programming language like, say, BASIC or Logo, that requires tens and twenties and hundreds of pages of program to do something, and a very abstract programming language, such as Smalltalk, which can do many interesting things in a couple of pages, then it's better to teach the abstract language to end users, non-programmers, than it is to try and teach the so-called easy programming language. Because in fact, having the programs be very small allows the person to use their visual field as an augmentation to their short-term memory. And that is the critical thing in end-user programming. And finally, the third fluency I call genre fluency. And by that I mean that for anything you can be literate in has a literature. And it's the very nature of literature that the literature is in different styles. So it's not just enough to be able to read and write, but you should be able to access other people's ideas by being able to absorb other styles of talking about things. And again, this is something that will be more and more important in the future as networking allows us access to more and more potentially useful tools that right now we can't use because we can't sit down and absorb a different style. And here we're talking about more than just the user interface. Having a uniform user interface like on the Macintosh is important, but it's not enough. And one final set of ideas. McLuhan pointed out, mentioned that Whitehead had called the greatest invention of the 19th century being invention itself. And Whitehead substantiated that by pointing out that the number of crackpot inventions in the patent office in England had gone up by more than a factor of 30 starting in the early 1800s, that everybody was inventing. People were inventing automatic hat-tipping devices and strangely shaped bicycle seats and every other kind of thing. Amazing. Anything that could be thought of and some things we'd never think of were patented. A huge explosion. And the important thing about that was that the number of good things went up by a factor of 3. And that factor of 3, coupled with the Industrial Revolution, changed the way we do things. McLuhan said, if the greatest invention of the 19th century was invention, then the 20th century is the century in which change changed. Our whole notion of what we meant by change over the last 10,000 years has changed in the 20th century. And so here's an example. And this is a list compiled by Jim Cook, who's a corporate thinker on the East Coast. It's kind of interesting. So the mission of the industrial age was to amplify the body, and the mission of the information age is to amplify the mind, he says. Structure of the industrial age is a hierarchy. The information age is naturally a network. The output, products and services, but the new output is ideas and decisions. Advantage, economy of scale. Now it's timeliness and leverage. Old goal, efficiency. New goal, effectiveness. Manages activity. Now we manage communication. Control was centralized. Now it's going to be decentralized. Medium is measurables. New medium is concepts, so forth. Evaluation is in reports. Now we believe. Sensitivity is to organizational structures. Now it's to talent. Cohesion is through discipline. New cohesion is through commitment. Risk return incremental. Now it's volatile. The leaders used to be dogmatic. Now they're charismatic. And the heroes used to be specialists, but now they're going to be generalists. I subscribe to most of these things, that this way of looking at things says that it's more than just incremental changes that are going on in this century. It's a whole different way of thinking about doing things.
I totally missed the lesson.
Well, it's just that there's a guy by the name of Lewis Mumford who used to write interesting books about how civilizations organize themselves to accomplish tasks. And one of the terms he made up was called, that civilizations he called the mega machine. He was very interested in what the mega machine was set up to do. He thought of offices and businesses as being communications devices. And when you set up a business, it's ostensibly to sell goods and services, perhaps, but what it really is a communications device. And he's very interested in what the business was as a system, and what you can do with a hierarchical organization, what you can't do. How flexible is a hierarchical organization, say, to corruption at the top, versus how flexible is a network-organized organization to corruption anywhere. He was interested in the difference between simple mechanical systems as applied to human sociology versus more biological systems, systems that are more tissue-like. And so I'm just putting those out there as a way of pointing out that the very structures in which organizations use to communicate and move ahead is changing. It's partly changing simply because the way we can move information around is different. I mean, one of the ways of thinking about how humans have gotten ahead over the last 10,000 years could be thought of as each stage of civilization has found a way of making an abstraction into an object. 10,000 years ago, words were not objects. Oral society, words are not objects. They can't be put down in a way so that you can stand back from them. People marveled at St. Augustine because he was one of the few people in his time that could read without reading aloud and moving his lips. When people read medieval manuscripts, even up to the 1400s, they read aloud, and they read slowly, because they were essentially an oral culture. The writing system that they had was a way of capturing oral culture, not changing the culture. McLuhan tells a really interesting story, fascinating story, about a tribe in Africa that had just recently achieved literacy via some missionaries that had helped them make up a syllabary, like Hindi, but a syllabary of some 60 or so signs that stood for the syllables in their language. And several people in each village had learned to read this syllabary. And the story that McLuhan tells is that when a letter came into the village, it would go to the person who could read it, to the family who had received the letter. And if the letter was a personal letter, the person who read the letter to the family would put his fingers in his ears as he read the letter, so he couldn't hear. Now think about that. Think about that, because that's what I'm trying to say, that McLuhan said, I don't know who discovered who discovered water, but it wasn't a fish. In other words, it is the stuff that we're embedded in that we take for granted that shapes us. There's no reason why human beings have to be the way they are in any particular culture. There are many different ways of doing things. And the thing that we're least aware of is the way our culture does things. So people like Mumford and McLuhan are tremendously useful in that they point out how different are the ways that people have solved their problems and how different it is, for instance, to read fluently in a print medium in which none of the emotion is expressed in the form of the text. The illuminated manuscripts were there as a kind of a stage setting to bring forth the emotion that was essentially a poetic expression of things. Prose is something that really became possible with the printing press, and our reaction, the way we read prose, is totally different. The way we get emotion from prose is totally different from the way we do when we were in oral culture. So in fact, this is a good place for this. Another one of these triads. Solving the problem is often futile. It definitely is in futurism. Changing the problem is what the books tell you to do. But in fact, changing the context is almost always the most powerful. And the reason for this is that logic is basically a weak method. We're not any smarter than we were thousands of years ago. And if we were put back, take any person in this room, put them back in 60 AD and try and get them to multiply two numbers using Roman numerals, we would see just how smart we looked. So representation systems are the things that are powerful. Our ability to do logical thinking has changed about the same. So this was a slogan that we liked at Xerox PARC that I made up called "Point of view is worth 80 IQ points." And that slogan was made up when we were developing the user interface that led to the Macintosh. What we're trying to do is, instead of trying to change the human species so that they could run MS-DOS, or the MS-DOS of the day, thank goodness it wasn't around when PARC was thriving, but there were equally bad systems back then, what we asked was, what is the context that can make people look smart on a computer? What is the one that allows them to use the logical operations that they've learned all their life, that will translate into actually controlling the computer, and that's what led to the familiar Macintosh user interface. So what caught business data processing off guard in the past decade? Well, I think desktop micros certainly surprised them. So they were out buying IBM mainframes. Spreadsheets surprised them. Universal bitmap graphics, such as on the Macintosh, that is graphics without any modes, where you don't have to say ahead of time when you're designing the machine what can go on the screen. Pointing window interfaces like the Macintosh, desktop publishing, local area networking, all of those things were a big surprise over the last 10 years. And the business data processing people are still scrambling to try and figure out what it all means. They want to play it safe, but they suspect now that, sort of like a Christian Scientist with appendicitis. You know, it's sort of one of those ultimate conflicts that you don't quite know what to do. Now, I'm not going to talk about, I just want to go through a list that obvious changes in the next 5 years I'm not even going to talk about. Many of the changes in the next few years you can see by going over to the Apple World Expo. Multi-megabyte RAM, faster CPUs per user, pervasive networking, 3-pound computers, application kits and generators, higher level language programming, very high level language, expert system prototyping, fast deductive reasoning, and some more attempt at standards, particularly at the network level. Those are all obvious things, and I don't think they deserve too much comment here. Some less obvious changes in the next 5 years. Now, the machines we did at PARC, first machine we did at PARC, if you were to benchmark it today, was about as fast as the Mac 2, which is wonderful. It's wonderful that the Mac 2, all of us that some of the old systems we used to do, like Smalltalk, run beautifully on the Mac 2, and we just love it. But what's been happening in the industry is something that's pretty annoying, and it has to do a lot with the physical form of RAM memory. And that is the bandwidth per bit in memories has been going down. What do I mean by that? Well, I mean that in order to get bandwidth in memory, you have to configure the memory in a certain width. If you make a 16-bit wide memory, and you have to buy a 1 megabit chip, then 16 of those 1 megabit chips will give you 2 megabytes of memory 16 bits wide. That's not very fast these days. So if you want to go faster, you can go to a 32-bit wide memory. That says you have to buy 16 more of those chips. That says that in order to have a single 32-bit wide memory, you have to have 4 megabytes of memory. And it's still only 32 bits wide. See what I mean? As the memories get longer, you have to configure enormous memories in order to have a reasonable bandwidth per bit. and memories, and that's not so good. And what that means is that the MIPS per megabyte ratio has been going down. So the Macintosh, for instance, is about a 1 MIP processor, and it has about 1 MB of storage. And that, we think, is pretty bad, because the machines we built at Park had 3 MIPS. Let's see. Let me work it out. It had about a MIP per 100 kilobytes. So every 100 kilobytes of memory we built had at Park, we had a 1 million instruction per second of processor. And as we built a very big machine, we actually built in 1978 a machine that had 40 million instructions per second for doing all that stuff. And that is really important. So today's micros, in my opinion, are underpowered in processor speed for the amount of memory they have on them. And that's going to change. This is going to be this change of having many, many more millions of instructions per second for the size memory you have on your machine is going to be a big surprise to people over the next few years. Would not surprise me at all before 1990 to have 75 or even 100 MIPS on a desktop. No? Well, I'll show you why you need it. See, I told you these weren't so obvious. Part of the way we're going to get that is we're going to have many more CPUs per user. I'll give you an example. There are lots of different ways of trading off these two. But a good example of a new kind of architecture is the system called the connection machine at Thinking Machines Corporation. Okay, this machine is a machine that has 65,000 processors. Each processor is a 1 MIP processor. And each processor is attached to 4 KB of memory. Okay, so this is a 1 MIP processor for 4 KB of memory. And that's the machine. So in fact, there is no separate RAM. You have a 1 MIP processor on 4 KB of memory. You have 65,000 of them. And that is, now what can you do with a machine like that? Well, an example is inductive reasoning. I'll give you two examples that you'd find it hard-pressed to do on any other machine. One of them is doing information retrieval over large document spaces. One of the hardest things to do is to get a set of indexes that represent some theory you have about a set of documents. Okay, because people have a hard time assigning keywords, and full text retrieval tends to retrieve too much, if you've ever used a good full text system like Nexus. So the process on this machine is you start off like Nexus. You come up with a couple of keywords, and it retrieves a bunch of documents. And you look at these documents, and you score them. You say, oh, this is just the kind of document I want. This one is way off. And then what it does is it takes all the documents you like and intersects every non-trivial word in the document with each other. And what it comes back with is another set of keywords gotten out of this massive intersection. It does this intersection in about 1 second. And then what it does is then it retrieves from the entire database all the documents that match those guys, and you get to score again. Okay? And what's amazing about this, and there are several papers you can get from Thinking Machines Corporation if this intrigues you, is that after you do this 2 or 3 times, the keywords stabilize. And you get a keyword set that will retrieve just the kinds of documents that you want and almost always exclude the documents you don't want. Just a couple of passes. And this whole process to establish that takes just a few minutes. Now, this is just simply isn't possible to do. I'll give you one more example. One of the problems in expert systems is that expert systems know a lot about a narrow domain. But because they're basically deductive, there has to be a rule in the expert system to cover every case. So let's take a case where we're describing some symptoms to a medical system. And at some point, the system needs to know the common sense fact that men don't get pregnant. and somebody forgot to put that in there. And the typical expert system will just, boop, that's the end of it. Because the problem is that we figure there are somewhere between 200,000 and 500,000 common sense rules that we all learn over the first 20 years of our life that we use from getting from one expert island to another. And it's very hard to codify those. And people are trying to codify them now, because that's what's one of the things that's holding back expert systems. Now, in the connection machine, when it comes up to something like that, it doesn't stop. In fact, it doesn't even have a common sense rule base. What it actually looks at is the last 6 months of Reuters dispatches. So they just got the last 6 months of Reuters dispatch. And this is about 15 gigabytes of information. And in a second, literally a second, it is able to come up with a 99% probability that men don't get pregnant, because it has not found any mention of that in this general corpus that has to do with human life. And so it uses this inductive assumption to carry on in the deductive process of trying to figure out what disease has. So there are many others. I'm going to mention some of the graphical needs for densely parallel processors in a bit. But I guess the point is that almost everything that has to do with the economics of building computers has to do with what it costs you to package the components. And most of the things that are going to surprise us in the next 5 years are going to be when certain packaging thresholds change abruptly and surprisingly. One of them, as we see, is going to be 3D graphics. 3D graphics done in real time has been incredibly expensive for the last 20 years or so. I was in the original group at Utah that invented 3D graphics, and none of us had any idea it was going to take so long. But it's completely dictated by the economics of building systems that have 2,000 multipliers in them. And that's what it takes to do 3D graphics. I'll get to that in a minute. Another example is what you might call ultra-high-level language end-user programming and tailoring. This again is sort of a prediction, and I believe it's going to come true, not because it's easy, but because it almost has to become true if we're going to have 100 million computers in the United States instead of something like 20 million. That there's no way applications packages are going to be able to anticipate all of the needs without getting much more patchwork quilty than they are. And there has to be some way for end users to tailor the end results of the system and even build some from scratch. It's not going to be in any programming language that we know now. Common sense database, I've already talked about a bit. And this means the difference between specific ways experts do things and those 200,000 facts that everybody knows but are hard to write down. There's a wonderful research project in Texas at MCC right now done by Doug Lennett that is using an ingenious set of techniques for coming up with a common sense database. Interesting thing about how big is this database? He's done enough already. He's been doing it for 4 years now. He's done enough already to establish that the database is somewhere between 8 megabytes and 100 megabytes in size for all of the common sense facts that people in our civilization know. Now, if you think about it, that sounds large, but in fact, it's only 1/5 of a compact disk. Only 1/5 of a compact disk to have this. And you can think of this common sense database in many ways as being the quick draw of expert systems in the future. It's that set of stuff you want to have in a ROM that every expert system builder can rely on being there in a general inference engine. In fact, this next point speaks to that. In fact, the next several points do. That it's going to be the integration of expert systems that will make expert systems as useful as the tools that you now enjoy on the Macintosh. Expert systems right now are completely isolated, and they're partly isolated just because they're done in different languages, but a lot of it is that they're isolated, that there's no way for the inferencing mechanism to move from one place to the other. Another non-obvious technology. This is a technology that has been chugging along pretty nicely for 10 years, but nobody has noticed it in the micro world. It's what's called explanation generation. And an explanation generator is a program that can look at a data structure, knowing what the data structures are generally attempting to represent, and generate perfect English prose at any level of detail about what that data structure is. Okay? This is the exact opposite of a system that understands English input, which is a very hard problem, but systems that will be able to generate beautiful English output from representational structures will burst on the scene in the next 5 years. There'll be an overnight sensation because it's only they've been worked on for the last 20 years or so. It's just a technology that there's no hint of in the micro world right now. I mentioned inductive reasoning. Another less obvious change is that I believe that user interfaces are going to change completely over the next 5 and 10 years. And the reason for that change is going to be networking. One of the things you probably noticed when you put a hard disk on the Macintosh is that the nice browsing techniques of the Finder don't work so well anymore. You have to make things real small, and some people go back to lists and stuff, and all of a sudden, being able to browse 100 items changes completely when you have to browse upwards of 2,000 items. And this is something we found out at Xerox PARC in the mid-70s. And we started thinking about what that meant, especially when you get hooked up to networks that are also hooked up to networks, and you have hundreds of thousands of resources. And we thought that was rather like what happens when you wander into the Library of Congress in Washington, and you discover to your dismay that the card catalog room is much larger than your hometown library. And what do you do at the Library of Congress? Well, the first thing you do is find a person who is an expert in where things are. And that person will act as your agent during the time you're in the Library of Congress. The person does not know the answer to your question, but the person is an expert at the resources and pathways for finding the answer. So this notion of agent is an old idea in computer science. It goes back actually to the early 50s. late 50s, McCarthy thought it up. But there hasn't been enough pressure from the technology to develop agent-based interfaces until now. And finally, one of the things that we just absolutely need a factor of 100 more cycles for is what I call, remember we talked about one of the messages of the Mac is universal bitmap graphics. That means, universal just means you don't have to know ahead of time of what's going to be shown on the screen. And the big change in the next 5 and 10 years is going to be extending that to 3D real-time animated graphics and simulation. Now, let me give you some examples. I'm sort of going to be popping back and forth here. Is there a clicker up here? Yes, there is. I think it's always nice whenever Apple celebrates their invention of the personal computer. I always like to show the actual first personal computer because this is the machine called the Link, and it was invented at Lincoln Labs by Wesley Clark in 1962. There are about 3,000 of these built in the 60s, and a lot of their architecture were adopted by DEC when DEC invented the Mini. And it's really kind of a shame because I sort of believe when DEC looked at this machine, they thought, oh, what a great idea. But people don't understand displays, so we'll take that off and make it an option. And these tapes that look like DEC tapes were actually invented for this machine. They actually held the pages of the virtual memory this first personal computer had. So it had a swapping virtual memory run off these tapes. And DEC said, oh, but people don't understand virtual memory. We've got it. We'll put files on these tapes. So they took this technology and made them back into something like computer tapes. So this was a great idea that was way ahead of its time. Now, this is the invention of computer graphics, Ivan Sutherland's Sketchpad. And Sketchpad was not just a graphics system, but in fact it was a system that could do general purpose simulations. The graphics had meaning, and in fact the system was called Sketchpad because it would actually complete the drawings for you. The drawings you just put in roughly, and then you told the system what the drawings should be, and Sketchpad would complete the drawings. All this in the very first graphic system, and I'll show you an example of that. In 1962, summer of 1962, you see the familiar rubber band technique. Ivan Sutherland actually invented it. Here's something you haven't seen before. Points to the edges and says, I want these to be all mutually perpendicular, and Sketchpad figures out how to do that. So you're seeing a real-time expert system in action. Notice Sketchpad is the first system to ever have a window. Here's another example. Draws a couple of lines, he points to them, he says make them parallel and mutually perpendicular to the edge, and Sketchpad straightens up the drawing. Well, Sketchpad is also the first non-procedural programming system, and it's far, far more capable than VisiCalc or Lotus 1-2-3, because it can solve non-linear problems in many unknowns. So now he's making the guidelines invisible. You'll see this display jump around a lot because the TX2 computer that this is running on is many times larger than this room. And it's putting up every dot on the screen by brute force. In fact, it was the last computer to ever have its own roof. So here's another example. He wants to draw a rivet. He uses that cross place there as the center for the arc, and now by simply pointing to the edges and telling Sketchpad to straighten it up, that will drag the cross pieces, which will center the rivet, and Sketchpad completes the drawing. The reason I'm showing you this stuff is because the Macintosh 2, here he's showing that no matter how you distort it, the same general rules are followed. Macintosh 2 is the first microcomputer fast enough to be able to do this kind of computer graphics, and I predict that we'll see Sketchpad, what are called constraint-oriented graphic systems, popping up in the next several years. You have to have enormous computing power to do this in real time. Now he's showing that anything that you can make a drawing of, you can get instances of. The instances can be dynamically, again, you see the contrast here between this and Mac Draw, which doesn't allow you to dynamically drag complex things. It makes up a simplification of the complex thing for dragging purposes. And here are some more instances of the rivet. And the reason I call them instances and not copies, you'll see in a minute, because he doesn't like the cross piece on the rivet, so he goes back to the master drawing and makes the cross pieces transparent, and we now see that the rivets have felt that change dynamically. So Sketchpad is also the first true object-oriented programming system. And this, again, we will see on the Mac 2 in the next few years. I asked Ivan once, I said, Ivan, how could you possibly have done the world's first graphic system, the first non-procedural programming language, and the first object-oriented programming system all in 1 year, all by yourself? And he said, well, I didn't know it was hard. So this year is the 25th anniversary of this system. This is the 25th anniversary of computer graphics this year. Yes. Here's another something that we're going to see in the next few years. I'm moving up in time. This is Douglas Engelbart. This is about 1968 or so. And Doug Engelbart was the guy who invented hypertext systems. And he also invented the mouse, as you see. Black and white graphics. View specs for Windows. And he had this interesting idea that people shouldn't have to hunch over their desk. So the way you ran this system was, this was a lap board that went over your office chair, so you could put your feet up on your desk like you were used to, or scooted around the room. It's an idea whose time has not yet come in the microcomputer industry. Here's an example of that system. What I'm showing you here was taken live from the demonstration of the system done in 1968. So this is 19 years old. And it's something that I predict we'll be able to do next year.
If in your office, you as an intellectual worker, were supplied with a computer display backed up by a computer that was alive for you all day and was instantly responsive to every action you had, how much value could you derive from that? Well, this basically characterizes what we've been pursuing for many years in what we call the Augmented Human Intellect Research Center at Stanford Research Institute. So look what else we can do in here. I've got this file that's structured. If I want to see what's in there, I can walk down the hierarchy levels and see, or return. But there's another thing I can do. There's a root dice that I have here. So here, I'm afraid I'll need a different picture of the view. So here's what I drew with a picture drawing capability here. It's a slight map if I start from work. And here's the route I seem to have to go to pick up all the materials. And that's my plan for getting home tonight. But if I want to, I can say, the library, what am I supposed to pick up there? I can just point to that. And oh, I see, overdue books and all. Well, there was a statement there with that name on it. Go back. What am I supposed to pick up at the drugstore? I see, very interesting. All right. Market? Oh, I've already seen that. Right, there's snow like that. Gee, that's too much. Anyway, so we have this feature of structuring our material hierarchically, being able to move around it very well. When we get a hierarchy, such as I can show you here now, I can do things if I want to just say, I'd like to interchange produce and canned materials. Bingo. And they're all numbered rightly if I care to look. Interchanging them very quickly. Cans are going to get interchanged with produce. They do it and all gets renumbered. So I have ways of studying over, making different views, moving around, going to specified points.
Okay, well, there's lots more, but you might have been surprised by the speed of that system. Oh, I have to show you a couple more things. I happen to love this. This is one of the great inspirations of the stuff we did.
At the same time, I've seen that I have a repertoire of different entities. My character, knock off that character. Replace the character, make that P. So I have entities of all sorts that I can say I want to do operations on, and this basic structure that I can move over and study and get about very quickly. So that is the essence now. That's the essence of the tool we have. There are a lot of details that I've left out for you. It'll offer you a character. If I hit W, it'll say delete word. The arrow moves back and forth to give me feedback. My tracking spot changes. That gives me feedback. Now it tells me, since it's an arrow that is armed, I can do something. We get a lot of feedback. Let me restore a view like this to show you. This is more normally the way we work with feedback up here.
Okay, now the thing to notice here is this is actually a multiple window system, and each of the views had a view specs. He's going to be talking about those. The view specs are much more than just the view specs control the level of detail he sees, how things are presented, whether they're presented in an outline form or so forth. It's something that has never been done on a micro up till now.
Here I'm shown, it's not working. That's an echo register that normally gives you the last six characters that you use. Oops, not working. All right. The last six characters and left shifts continuously, so you can look up at any time and see, what have I just struck? and that's very good feedback. Here are characters that show me the different viewing parameters, view specs. They get large at times at which I can hit single strokes to change those view parameters.
Now notice here that the theory of interaction here is different. Engelbart understood very early that the thing you don't want to do is go moving constantly back and forth between the pointing device and the keyboard. And so this five-finger keyboard he has for the left hand allows him, when he moves his hands out to the outside, he can do anything with the five-finger keyboard that you can do with a regular keyboard, just a little bit slower. And so when he's zooming through the system, he'll just keep his hands constantly in navigation mode. And it's only when he's typing paragraphs that he uses the regular keyboard in the center. It's a more efficient way of doing things than we do things today.
And each of those means something to me, and their being large at particular times tells me I can hit very quick abbreviation for changing the view. So I can say, all right, I'd like to go to produce, but I'd like to go to produce, they get big, I'd like to say one branch only, and let me look just that low, and I see it. Oh, I can say, I'd like to see one line only, I can see it. So these ways I move around, the way I get feedback up here, the way I use both hands to coordinate to tell the computer what command and what short literals I want, are all carefully designed to go together to make the repertoire. I'd like to link to Bill, and I don't know what his terminal is right now, so I have to ask for somebody to connect me to him audibly. So Bill, will you come in through this intercom?
Oh, Doug.
Hi. I need to know what terminal you're on, Bill.
13.
Okay. I'd like to have him see my text. And so this special thing, if I label 13, will switch over. So on his display, he sees my text. So I'll execute it. And sure enough, it does. But what's that running around? Well, if he's looking at my text, he'd like to have something to say about it. So we put on a marker, a tracking spot that he controls. So he's sitting there in Menlo Park looking at this text. And he can point to it, but we've carefully reserved for me the right to control and operate on this. So
what's going on here is teleconferencing, because this system is organized. Engelbart is in San Francisco, and the rest of his group is in Menlo Park, but they're sharing the same screen, and every time a person joins the conferencing system, they get a new cursor so that they can point at things too. Now the system becomes a shared blackboard.
Is more powerful than yours. But we can have an argument. Yeah. That's what they call a bug fight. So, all right. So, in case you haven't been listening, Bill, we've been going through lots of examples and setting up in collaboration here so that we can go on into information retrieval. And we've set up now audio coupling, and we're both looking at the same display, and that'd be very handy to work. We can talk to each other and point, and maybe later I can hand you the chalk on this blackboard, like saying, here, you control it. But let's stay this mode now and add another feature that hardware-wise is available to the kind of display we have. I'd like to see you while I'm working on it. So before I can do that, I have to set up my display in a certain way. Set it up so I see it over like that. That leaves a corner up there, and I say, now, computer, do the automatic switching that'll bring in a camera picture from the camera mounted on his console, such as the camera mounted on mine is. Hi, Bill. That's great. Now we're connected audio. You can see my work. You can point at it, and I can see your face, and we can talk. So let's do some collaborating.
I had this immensely intuitive feeling that humans are going to be able to drive a great deal of capability from this. And along with that, it come very real images in my mind of sitting at a display console, interacting with a computer, seeing all sorts of strange symbology coming up that we could invent and develop to facilitate our thinking, since we would no longer be limited to working with paper and laborious means like that. And other people could be sitting at similar consoles tied to the machine, and you could be collaborating in brand new exciting ways, and that you could be just doing all sorts of things to control a computer. So I had enough engineering background, even though I didn't at that time know how the innards of a computer worked, but I certainly knew that if they can read a card, they can sense keys and any other action you want to do, and if they can drive a printer or a card punch, I knew plenty of electronics to know that they could put whatever you want on a display.
Okay, well, that was one of the great pioneers. Now, a lot of what he predicted is going to come to pass, because what he predicted was what we need. And the difference between these guys in the 60s and much of what's been going on in the micro industry is that these guys in the 60s seem to have these complete visions. So Ivan Sutherland didn't just invent computer graphics. He realized that the graphics wanted to simulate something with meaning. And Engelbart didn't just invent the mouse and a few things. He realized that the whole idea was that for people, not just one person, but for multiple people to be able to work together in a shared way. Now, this is the first personal computer I designed. It's called the Flex Machine in 1967. It was influenced a lot by Engelbart stuff. Turned out to be very hard user interface like Engelbart's was actually a fairly hard one for people to learn. And a little bit later, we saw Seymour Papert's work with Logo in 1968. And also this system, done at Rand Corporation. This is about 1968 also. Again, on a multi-million dollar machine larger than this room. For a bunch of Rand economists that complained that they couldn't type.
This list of processes takes us back to the topmost level.
So they got rid of the keyboard.
Start to edit the flow diagram. First, we erase a flow arrow, then move the connector out of the way so that we may draw a box in its place.
It's recognizing his handwriting here.
The printing in the box is being used as commentary only in this case. The box is slightly too large, so we may change its size.
Here's where Mac window control came from, literally.
Then draw a flow from the connector to the box. Attach a decision element to the box and draw a flow from it to scan. We then erase the flow arrows attached to the process post new area and move the box to a new position. This allows us to draw a new box, then chop off its corner and label it subscan.
Now notice it misses the N here. He goes up, he sees it, he hesitates, but it's modeless.
Draw a flow.
So he can just change it.
Post to subscan, correct the label, add a decision on subscan so that control may flow to the connector A0, then complete the diagram from scan to post.
Well, this system was the one that actually changed my way of thinking about computers, because this was a system that I felt to me intimate. I had a chance to use it for a half an hour in 1968, and I was knocked. Notice that the command, you didn't even see a pull-down menu. There, every command was analogical. If you want a box, you drew a box, and it made the box that size. If you wanted a character on the screen, you drew a character. If you want to get rid of something, you scrubbed it out. The text editor in it took normal proofreading symbols. So this is one of the great systems of all time that nobody has ever heard of these days, called Grail, Graphical Input Language. So that led to this notion that the pencil was the best metaphor, that thing we'd never withhold from children, and that the information vehicle that Engelbart liked wasn't as powerful as this notion of giving everybody a pencil. And also in 1968, the first plasma panel flat screen display was done, and so we realized that one of the destinies of all of this stuff had to be something that looked like this. We call this the Dynabook. And remember that it can't be just like a lap computer of today, because lap computers of today don't allow you to carry other things easily. It has to be really slim. It has to be really light. It has to be really good. It has to be really fast. To test those ideas, this is the forerunner of the Macintosh. It's a photograph about 1973. You can see the screen is about the size. In fact, it's exactly the same number of pixels as the Radius screen has, 808 by 606. And this machine was about the computing power of the Macintosh 2. It's about three times or four times the computing power of the Macintosh Plus. Windows, you're all familiar with, invented on that machine. Smalltalk was how we tried to work with creative literacy and get people to do their own applications programs, especially children. Here's a quick example. So here's a this is a wonderful crowd to explain this to, because this is an applications program like MacDraw. So it's an object-oriented graphic system. You just saw some selection handles there. Here's a color change. You see the menu down at the bottom of the screen. Here's a size change. Now, the only thing interesting about this program is it wasn't bought in a store. It was done in 1975, and it was designed and implemented by a 12-year-old girl after just 3 months of programming in Smalltalk 72. So this is an example of a real live tool done by a novice programmer, a child. And one of the nicest things about the Macintosh 2 is it is the first microcomputer fast enough to be able to run a language like Smalltalk. So this is the kind of stuff we'll be able to do with school children now for real. And in fact, Apple has an extensive project here in Los Angeles that uses powerful Macintoshes in a grade 1-6 school. So end user programming is something that's going to happen in the next few years. That's the Vivarium project. And I'll say a few words about it, if I can hold your interest for another few minutes. So one of the questions you might ask is how young a child can actually use these techniques. And here's a tape that I got about 5 months ago from the woman who's my accountant. This little girl is the daughter of my accountant. And her parents both work at home. Each of her parents has a Macintosh. And when I found out the little girl was interested in computers, I gave her an Apple II, which she rejected. She wanted a Macintosh just like her folks. And in fact, we actually did, I did go against my belief in market survey. We tried a market survey on this 22-month-old and discovered that she vastly preferred Macintoshes with hard disks. In fact, this is what we used to call in the bad old days 2 years ago, Mac pause. Now, actually, it's a little surprising to child psychologists that she can watch the screen and use the mouse, perform this displacement at such an early age. Given that, it's not too surprising that she can hit visible menu items in Mac Paint here. So when I saw this, I wasn't, I was intrigued, but I wasn't too surprised that she could do it. But what happened next really surprised me. She wants a fresh sheet, so she goes up to the close box on the window, saves your file with a pop-up, uses the pull-down to get a new one, and she's off and rolling again. That's spray painting. And here's something that Piagetians say she shouldn't be able to do yet, which is the reversible operation of erasing. And she thinks of the hand as animation. And in fact, we're starting to do some animation things with her. Now, she was 22 months old when this was taken. Of course, kids have this. She's not 22 months now, unfortunately. When something like this happens, you like to freeze them in stasis, because so great. But after we saw that, her father had taken the picture. What we got is a Mac with a video out, and we ran a line to a monitor in a bedroom and set up another camera. And then we got many hours of her interacting with the machine and determined that she was able to handle about 75% of the commands and the pull-downs consistently, and not just in Mac Paint, but in several systems. And and her obvious interest in animation is something that we're planning on doing something about. Another thing that's interesting is the intriguing possibility that if the Macintosh interface is the first interface that reaches, she is actually able to use the mouse more adroitly than she can use a crayon at this age. And it raises the possibility of building an question answering system for a child age 3 to 6. They have lots of questions then, to allow them to ask questions and get answers without having to use an adult as an intermediary. And that's something that I'm very interested in, but I fear it may change the sociology of the home.
Probably for the better.
Maybe for the better. So very quickly, here's this this project that we're doing in Los Angeles. Very similar to the one we did at Park, except at Park we were asking the question, what would it be like for novice programmers, especially children, to do their own applications programs? And here in the Vivarium project, we're asking the question, what would it be like for novice programmers, especially children, to do their own artificial intelligence programming? So we want to know something fundamentally new about what it means to program up mentalities. And the way we're asking that question is to set up a forcing function. So we have this wonderful school in Los Angeles called the Open Magnet School, all 226 children. And this is actually an inner city school, though it doesn't look like it, because this is part of their asphalt playground that they tore up to make a garden, where the second and third graders learn about biology by actually growing things. This is sort of the saran wrap free system of education. Food doesn't come published and packaged in saran wrap. Here's a typical thing that we do in the vivarium is the children might study an ocean ecology, like a tide pool, lots of different animals and plants interacting. They might get interested in fish. And besides just drawing fish, we would like to give them some magic computer stuff, like Mac Draw stuff, that they can mold, use distortions like Darcy Thompson showed at the turn of the century, that related species have related body plans. Conformal mappings can be made from one end to the other. Animate the fish. And most importantly, give the fish behavior. Actually program up a mentality of the fish based on their observations of what fish do. And for that, we have to invent lots of things. We want to have multiple points of view, like here's one from the fish's point of view. We want to see the world from the frog's point of view, from the heron's point of view, and from all of the points of view simultaneously. Because it's multiple points of view. Remember, points of view are worth 80 IQ points. Multiple points of view are how you actually learn. And we want the graphics to look something like this. This is a scene from Bambi, and we're privileged to have with us the person who did Bambi, Frank Thomas, the old Disney animator, who is one of the advisors on this project and is in the process of teaching every child in the school how to animate. Here's another example, a scene from Fantasia in which every frame was airbrushed by hand. Okay, only computers, this kind of animation will never again be done by hand. Only computers can bring this level of aesthetics. And here's an example. And this, to be able to do this in real time, takes about 10 times the power of the Macintosh 2. So about 10 to somewhere between 10 and 30 MIPS. And you notice it's sort of hard to see what's going on. Now, to turn the sun on, like this, the very same scene, takes on the order of 100 MIPS.
Is that done with Pixar?
Now, this is done by Bob Abel, and it's done very slowly. This is done on a VAX, about the same power. To do this on a Macintosh 2 would take about 20 or 30 minutes a frame. But it's a very nice metaphor to make something alive out of just raw material. So the problem with waiting 20 and 30 minutes a frame is that you probably notice that children are very real-time devices. And so in order to to actually get something that's closer to their rates of speed, we use this Evans and Sutherland flight simulator. This is real-time computer graphics, 60 frames a second, and there's a human pilot flying this plane. So the system does not know where he is going to go. Wherever he goes, it has to show him this planetoid-sized database. Now you get an idea of what the state of the art. This is the state of the art in real-time computer graphics. You can get an idea of, look at the sky, look at the leaves in the trees. So the modeling is at a very high level of detail. And this system is able to show these simulations from multiple points of view simultaneously. This is a Harrier jump jet. So this is the equivalent. So we're seeing this from about 100 feet off the ground, and simultaneously, here's a ground level view. Now think of this. This is the equivalent of those million-dollar computers in the 60s that Sketchpad and Grail were done on. And here's a third simultaneous view from the cockpit of the second plane. So of course, we weren't that interested in marine jump jets, because we've been talking about fish. So we took our Disney animators and a couple of Apple people, and we went off to Evans and Sutherland in Salt Lake City to see if we could do 1,000 miles of Australian Barrier Reef and some swimming things. And Disney animators have this way of turning everything into a character. And one of the things that's not been done successfully in real-time graphics is sinuous motion. So we got very interested in how fish move their tails and scull their way through the water. So we did lots of drawings of that. And of course, sharks have a sort of a evil scanning eye, which we put in. So the result of one long weekend with lots of cold pizza and this several million-dollar machine is this. So what you saw there is about somewhere between 100 and 150 million instructions per second to do that in real time, or about 50 Macintosh 2 equivalents of computing. Now, 50 is an interesting number because that first machine I showed you at Xerox, the forerunner of the Macintosh, was exactly 50 times as fast as a console on a PDP-10 timesharing system. We forget what it was like so many years ago. It was incredibly slow to do computation, interactive computation, back in the late 60s and early 70s. And the real breakthrough at Xerox PARC was that factor of 50 that made everything different. The breakthrough that we have today in the Macintosh 2 was a factor of 50 over the way people did things 20 years ago. And another factor of 50 is yet to come in the next few years. The most important thing about this 3D graphics stuff is that it has not been possible to make a real-time system like this in anything smaller than a couple of full racks of equipment because of the way packaging of chips has gone. This is one of these things that's going to go through an immense step function of several orders of magnitude change in cost performance just in the next few years, because the level of integration of chips is quivering on the edge for being able to package a system like that on one or two cards that would fit inside a Macintosh 2.
You don't need 50 slots.
Don't need 50 slots. So I guess I should close this off with my favorite way of thinking about this is that the Greeks held that the visual arts were the imitation of life, but the computer arts, in which we're all interested, are the imitation of creation itself. And Pavisi, the Italian philosopher, said, to know the world, one must construct it. And it's this, through this constructive process that children actually learn. Computers are the best construction material we've ever come up with outside of our own brains. I see them as an amplifier to the things that we bring when we sit down in front of the machine. An amplifier, not a prosthetic. Thank you very much. Thank you.